that in the world of the living, we have two kingdoms. We have, on one side, a kingdom where the plant is king, and on the other hand, where the animal is king. That I get from my senior one, secondary class one of biology, when we are classifying the living things according to kingdoms. And a special attention is drawn to the center of activity in these kingdoms. At the center of activity in all these kingdoms is one key purpose. And put that word in caps, for it is the reason for my speaking today. Purpose. All living things, if they are to stay living, they must have a purpose. And whether you're animal or plant, the purpose, the best purpose, the best dream is to survive. And thus goes the saying that it is always survival for the fittest. The question I want to pose to each one of us this morning is, how fit are you? Because like it or not, you have and you are in the same battle of survival. But my attention still goes deeper to the special, to a special kind in the animal kingdom called a species. The species, a special species called man. And like all other animals in the kingdom, man has a special trait, a peculiar trait of thinking beyond survival. Man has the cognitive ability to look at themselves now, yesterday, and tomorrow. In the animal kingdom, we are the only species that has that ability. And I don't want to think that the good Lord who made all of us gave us that ability for no reason. I'm talking about purpose. Man has the ability to look at their present and try to understand their present in light of yesterday and in light of the tomorrow they don't know, but they long to achieve. And that's what makes us different from all our brothers and sisters in the animal kingdom. I read from the Bible, in the book of Genesis, of a man who was made and placed in a garden. And when he was placed in the garden, instructions came from the Creator, and one of the very special instructions was to work. One would be quick to ask that why would man placed in a perfect world have to work? Ladies and gentlemen, God is making a statement from the first word that man should always make sure they become better. The garden was perfect, but there was better. And man was supposed to make that happen. I didn't come to preach, and I'm not a preacher. But I want to speak to your mind about the importance of having a purpose. He that has a purpose is not one that is in the category that looks at survival, but one that qualifies to be in a special category that looks at the future. As we live, we strive to become better. Ladies and gentlemen, science has also told us that in the struggle of man to become better and to survive, there are stages. We have a number of us that have been able to cross from one stage to another, and those that are still struggling in a certain stage of life. Several scientists and sociologists have come up with a number of philosophies whose aim has been to understand the struggles and inspirations of man. An example of these scientists is Maslow, and the other is myself. I live a philosophy of my own self in light of all other existing philosophies, because I'm one who believes that the God who endowed me with this mind purposed me to use it to improve myself. So I qualify myself as one of the philosophers who have tried to deeply think about the struggles and inspirations of man. And I have come to realize that the difference between our philosophies, mine and all the other philosophers, is more in form, and to the greater extent, we agree in substance. But allow me to ignore the difference and concentrate on the intersections between or among our philosophies. All our philosophies in union agree that to a very great extent, man is innately, without compulsion or without thought, tuned into the gear and mood of survival. I was speaking to a doctor friend, and he told me that almost a good percentage of all deaths are suicidal deaths. And this hit me hard. He said, how come? So someone gets sick and then they die, and he said, that's suicidal. He said, yes. The human brain will always work to make sure it survives. So that's why when you get sick and get on your sickbed, the mind will listen and sense every ounce of energy that flows through your bloodstream. And it measures in proportion to the energy requirements in your system. And as you grow weaker, as the energy cuts down, the brain starts switching off organ by organ. It will take off sensation by sensation. You'll stop smelling, you'll stop tasting, you'll lose sight. And what the brain is trying to do in all that is to make sure it reduces the amount of energy that goes in all other aspects of life, as long as it maintains the energy that goes to itself for survival. And the last kick of the brain eventually happens when it has to cut out energy to its own self. And that's when the sad announcement is made and the obituary notices are out that we have lost him. And unconsciously, the brain has said, I've done my part. I've worked for survival. Ladies and gentlemen, that is inert in us. We don't have to think about survival. Our bodies are made to survive. But we have to think about a very important aspect in life, and that is improvement. Improving who you were today. The philosophies that I talked about have also come to agree that there is no question about the two, survival and improvement. They've also come to agree that the challenge and man's biggest responsibility, therefore, is to establish and answer the question of how. How to survive and how to improve. That is man's greatest responsibility, at least according to the philosophers. That fact resonates well with each one of us here today. From the time of our first breath, our systems are in a daily struggle of devising means to keep us alive. Our minds are occupied with being better than yesterday. This is regardless of whether we know it or not, whether we accept it or not. I want to think that every one of us today, before you moved out of your house, the first thing you did was to say a prayer if you did say one. But the next was to think about how to come here appearing better than you woke up. Possibly move to a shower house or a shower room, took a bath, washed your face, brushed your teeth, then got your dressing on, got your gel on, and had to find a lotion or something or a perfume to get yourself smelling better. And ladies and gentlemen, that is who human beings are. Of course, I may not know your reasons, but one thing that I certainly know is that you long to have a tomorrow that is better than today and yesterday. You long to have a new year that is more pleasant than yesteryear. So in the quest of making ends meet, our minds, as like I said, always ask for tools in the quest to answer the question of how. How we can survive and how we can make better. So these tools may not be an end in themselves, but a means to an end. Among the tools the world has come to appreciate as being able to answer the question of how is the tool of solving another man's problem for a payment that will help solve your own. I've learned from Francis and the like who specialize in money that what we call money today has its history in a transaction between man and man called barter trade, where one man would give in exchange what they have to get what they do not have. That went on evolving over time across waters, across continents, until one man one day identified a special mineral in the ground, one that would make one look better, more beautiful. Keyword, better. And this mineral was copper. And he said, if you get this mineral and put it around you in form of a bracelet or put it around your neck, then you look better. Little wonder when the devil approached Adam and Eve in the garden, it was still the same story of better. I read the story and I wonder how we were lured into better. But I wonder less, because I realized after all that man was created to deserve and long for better. So when this gentleman or a lady invented copper and convinced everyone that he could make them look better, he said, but I would give you an ounce of copper for a sack of flour, for a sack of maize, or for a sack of corn, or for a sack of beans, and the such like. So he purposed himself to be one that is to be called the copper smelter, and the others to be the farmers. What this gentleman or lady did was to create a value and convinced the rest that he had created value. And they were willing to exchange survival, food, for copper. The story goes on and on and on until we have gold, and gold grows to become such a very precious item that even the security around it became questionable. So a central place was established that could keep gold, and a certificate would be issued to whoever went and deposited an ounce of gold or more in the store, in the bank, in the central bank of gold. So they would give you a certificate and they would indicate that Peter has deposited with us at the central bank 50 ounces of gold. And therefore I could get that certificate and go to Mary and tell Mary, this what you see is the certificate of proof that I have value that I created. And that value is gold, and it weighs this much. Please give me 4 sacks of corn, and in exchange, I'll give you a portion of my gold. So an inscription will be made on the certificate of gold that Peter has lost the 20 ounces of gold to Mary in exchange for this. But you see, the certificate grew too dirty, too old, and too long. That they said, no, let us have special cards in everyone's name, indicating how much gold they have in the reserve. And ladies and gentlemen, that's how we evolved to have what we call paper money today. But why am I telling you all that? The biggest point that I want to bring out in that story is the story of creating value. As we strive to attain our purpose, our vision of becoming better, there is a very big question along the way that we must answer. What value are you creating? Because every man stands on the value that they create. If you are looking at improving yourself in the new period of counting that people have chosen to call a year, 2021, take this home, that you will only stand on the value you've created for 2021. And the same will be the same story for 2022. If you are to stand better in 2022, then create the value in 2021. The important tool of man solving another man's problem for a payment that would help solve his own, ladies and gentlemen, is what we understand today as employment. We might choose to qualify the word with so many other terminologies as self-employed. I don't know the other terms, but I will stick to the term employment. Employment is a tool by which we attain what we want to attain by giving others what they want to attain that we can give. I've been invited at several occasions to speak to workers in organizations, and I've always asked the question, why are you here? The same answer has always come across. I'm here to get what to do and get something to take home. Ladies and gentlemen, that's not wrong, and that is the most genuine answer. We are always where we are because we want something that will make us better. But in the process, the other person is asking that as I'm making you better, how are you making me better? How are you making me better? Like all opportunities, ladies and gentlemen, there is an opportunity. I'll call it a blessing since I'm a Christian, of having the chance to be employed, of having the chance where someone says, I think I see value in what you can do, and I'm willing to part with a portion of what I have for what you're doing. If you ever thought of the blessings that you have from the Almighty, that is one. That someone who is not yourself or your relative has sat back and said, I see value in what you do, and I'm willing to surrender a portion of what I've worked for in exchange for what you have. And ladies and gentlemen, like all opportunities, they're not opportunities until we qualify the quality of them by how we respond to the opportunities. For the opportunities that we get, and the opportunity of employment in particular, is one of the tools of man that solve the biggest puzzle of man, the puzzle of how. It creates a means to an end that is not known, but that is sought. The achievement of your purpose of improving yourself in the future lies to a very greater extent on how you treat the opportunities of today. Ladies and gentlemen, life has no rehearsal. It does not offer us a second chance to relive even the most recent second. So every time you come out to do something, the world expects you to be perfect. Because you cannot relive that moment. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, they that strive to be better tomorrow must understand the importance of today. Every opportunity you get to show the world what you can be of importance is an opportunity to set ground for your today, but most importantly, for your tomorrow. Ladies and gentlemen, the Black Wall Street has today given you an opportunity to show the world what you can do, how much value you can create, and therefore, how much you are worth. Your response to this opportunity is key in setting ground for what you will become. I'll conclude by telling a very short story. In the year 2009, I was concluding my high school. And when I was done with my last exam, I packed my bags because I was in boarding school and returned home. My dad called me to the table and congratulated me for having completed that phase of life. And he told me, son, now we move to the real world. So he signed me up in his school. He owned a secondary school and signed me up there as a teaching assistant in physics and mathematics. I had majored in physics, mathematics, and chemistry at my A-level with a subsidiary qualification in entrepreneurship studies. So my father gives me this job and tells me, go, you're now on your own. I just made about 18 years then, of age. So when I got to the school, I did what I knew, that was teaching physics and mathematics as a teaching assistant, helping the young boys and girls like myself understand these complex aspects, and that was the task before me every day. But you see, man is an animal, and like all animals, we always have what we call the herd's effect. The mind of living in a herd, of thinking in groups. So, with that background, I always formed teams with the other employees that I found in the school. And you know, because I was a staff too, what they went through, I went through. I remember most of the times we would sit in the staff room and complain together about how bad things are going and discuss the beautiful girls. But the most important thing that I want to share with you from this story is that while we were sitting in the staff room, I was having these conversations with people who were not children of my father. And little did they think when we were in the group that I was a son of my father. And this was my father's school. That even if I made certain mistakes, maybe my father would listen. Ladies and gentlemen, we live in groups, but we're individuals. And that's why I want to draw to your attention this morning, a very important aspect of your life, and that's what I call purpose. You cannot become anything better at your work if you're not determined to become something better for your own self. For everything that we do for others, it is first for ourselves and for our own gain and benefit. That is who we are. The other thing that I noted in the staff room while I was with my fellow teachers is the subconscious part of the mind that registers and takes notes even when you don't think we're taking notes. That some of the people, ladies and gentlemen, you are now at the Black Wall Street. You have people around you, you're doing whatever you're doing. Trust me, people are taking notes of you. You want to get proof of that? Simply get three people of you. Get the three of you sit in a place and just talk business. Trust me, the moment one of you walks away, the two of you, the two that remain, will start discussing the one that has left. Do I lie? And this is not because they lack what to do or because they interest in discussing people. But that is what humanity is. It is cognizant of even the smallest detail that surrounds it. So when you walk away, our minds automatically tell us, are itching to share to one another what we're observing about the person who has just left. I know that when I leave this place today, the same is going to happen about me. Whoever is seated here is taking notes of who this man is. God help me that the best will be said about me. Ladies and gentlemen, I was given only 20 minutes to speak. I don't know how much I've used. I apologize if I've gone beyond that. But in conclusion, you must determine to be new if you are to be better in the new year. There are no shortcuts. In our animal kingdom, it is a jungle. And in the jungle, it is survival for the fittest. So ladies and gentlemen, every time you come out in the jungle, prove to the other animals that surround you that you can create value and you are the fittest to survive in the jungle. For your audience, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you.